Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
By the 1950s, the idealistic interpretations of World War II had long faded, replaced by a restless malaise that imbued American cinema.
What we've got here is failure to communicate.
The American people began to abhor the institutions and structures that straitjacketed all forms of art and creative expression. The United States hired prominent directors like Frank Capra to counteract the infamous Nazi propaganda scheme imposed by Joseph Goebbels and Leni Riefenstahl. The studio system hammered production into a formulaic assembly line, a well-oiled, efficient machine. What ensued throughout the 1940s was Hollywood's crowning jewel, the zenith of its golden age, but the nadir in regards to boundary-pushing studio films. The Cold War stretched on, hypocrisy writ large among politicians, angering the general public. The latent threat of nuclear war loomed forefront in many minds. The Vietnam War began in 1955, with U.S. involvement lasting until 1973. Some Americans, veterans included, believe this to be an intrusion into a foreign civil war the United States had no business joining in the first place. Nixon may have ended the U.S. presence in Vietnam, but another storm was brewing. Watergate sowed the seeds of distrust between citizens and politicians. Nixon was humiliated into resignation because of his ignominious actions and the cover-up that followed. The flower child activism of the 60s and the politically charged psychedelia of the 1970s illuminated the divide between generations, rich and impoverished, Republicans and Democrats.
Frank! I'm an officer! I'm a police officer!
Jesus, Frank, how was I supposed to recognize you? You stupid fuck.
Institutions believed to be upstanding and ethical were exposed as the rotting and corrupt carcasses they really were. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. The studio system and the American government initiated a symbiotic relationship in the throes of World War I. Propaganda reels and informative news typically preceded film showings, swaying an audience simply searching for a mode of escapism. Following World War I was the Great Depression. Movie tickets became far cheaper than more sophisticated fare of theater and musical performances. Hollywood flourished. An estimated 65% of Americans went to the movies per week in the 1930s.
I'll get you, my pretty.
But after the upheaval of the Great Depression and World War II, the Red Scare of McCarthyism sent fear and anxiety permeating throughout the United States. The House Un-American Activities Committee, or HUAC, prosecuted those in Hollywood with potential ties to communism. Names like Orson Welles, Burl Ives, Lena Horne, and Charlie Chaplin were disparaged. Because of this, any sort of experimentation within the studio system was rare, for fear of retaliation. If the hallmarks of the 1940s were propaganda and paranoia, the 50s appeared to be right on track. But bubbling beneath the surface was the outrage at the Hays Code, an enforcement of censorship beginning in 1934 that prohibited nudity, suggestive dances, and mockery of religion. Depiction of drug use, corporeal disease, childbirth, and use of profanity was forbidden.
Where shall I go? What shall I do?
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
That famous line from Gone with the Wind led to controversy over the use of the word damn. Criminal behavior could not be depicted in a sympathetic or glamorous way. Murder scenes could not illustrate brutality for fear of inspiring real-life killings. Adultery and illicit relationships, although occasionally necessary to plot, could not be explicit, justified, or alluring. Films could not be released if they did not adhere to the Hays Code. And when all this suppression and restriction reached a boiling point, the volcano erupted, and not a single revered institution remained unscathed. All About Eve dismantled the ageist and sexist culture of Hollywood.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
High Noon functioned as an allegorically reflective takedown of the Red Scare blacklisting occurring at the time. It was written by Carl Foreman, an ex-member of the American Communist Party who was subpoenaed to testify against his friends in the HUAC hearings during the filming of High Noon. He refused, and his career was sabotaged because of it. The script is chock-full of trope subversions and revisionist Western hallmarks. The film ends with Gary Cooper throwing down his badge, abandoning his job, and riding off into the sunset. On the Waterfront is arguably the polar opposite of High Noon. The film criticizes the American political climate and corruption of power, and has been reevaluated as director Elia Kazan's response to severe backlash after his naming of 8 suspected communists during the HUAC hearings.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody. Instead of a bum, which is what I am, let's face it.
Would you like me to tell you the little story of right hand, left hand? The story of good and evil? H-A-T-E. It was with this left hand that old brother Cain struck the blow that laid his brother low. L-O-V-E. You see these fingers, dear hearts, these fingers has veins that run straight to the soul of man. The right hand, friends, the hand of love. Now watch and I'll show you the story of life. These fingers, dear hearts, is always a warring and a tugging, one against the other. Now watch them. Old brother left hand hates a fighting, and it looks like love's a goner. But wait a minute. Wait a minute. Hot dog loves a winning. Yes, sirree. It's love that won, and old left hand hate is down for the count.
The Night of the Hunter portrayed a lying, smooth-talking, crooked pastor who manipulates a widow for her husband's money, a departure from the pious priest archetype. 12 Angry Men challenge flaws of the justice system and the racism structurally internalized in its characters, while also debating on class, biases, and American nationalism. It even inspired Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor to pursue a career in law. Cat on a Hot Tin Roof depicted the unhappiness between a Southern married couple and other family members. The husband, played by Paul Newman, is an aging football star struggling with guilt regarding his best friend's suicide. The film attacks conventional marriage dynamics, cultural perceptions of sexuality, and parental relationships. Due to the Hays Code, the film largely dances around these topics, but subtextually hammers them
pain,
home.
And sweat, and paying bills, and making love to a woman that you don't love anymore. Truth is dreams that don't come true, and nobody prints your name in the paper till you die.
Shadows, appraised as a milestone in American independent cinema, centers around race relations and is groundbreaking in its portrayal of womanhood.
Who do you belong to, Lillian?
Well, I belong to me.
We are rapidly approaching a moment of truth, both for ourselves as human beings and for the life of our nation. Now, truth is not always a pleasant thing. But it is necessary now to make a choice, to choose between two admittedly regrettable, but nevertheless distinguishable post-war environments. One where you got 20 million people killed, and the other where you got 150 million people killed.
You're talking about mass murder, General, not war.
Mr. President, I'm not saying we wouldn't get our hair mussed. But I do say no more than 10 to 20 million killed, tops, depending on the breaks.
I will not go down in history as the greatest mass murderer since Adolf Hitler.
Perhaps it might be better, Mr. President, if you were more concerned with the American people than with your image in the history books.
Dr. Strangelove is a Cold War satire that is equally irreverent towards American and Russian obstinance. In an essay from esteemed critic Pauline Kael, she writes, "In Bonnie and Clyde, we see that killers are not a different breed, but are us without the insight or understanding or self-control that works of art strengthen. Bonnie and Clyde, by making us care about the robber lovers, has put the sting back into death."
Well, I would say that I'm just drifting here in the pool.
Why?
Well, it's very comfortable just to drift here.
Have you thought about graduate school?
The Graduate highlights a directionless and unmotivated college graduate, further equating the isolation and uncertainty synonymous with the baby boomer generation that established the counterculture movement.
Well, you're pretty sure of yourself, ain't you, Virgil? Virgil, that's a funny name for a nigger boy that comes from Philadelphia. What do they call you up there?
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
Sidney Poitier's watershed performance illustrated a nuanced and highly intelligent character, an outlier for studio films in the 60s. Additionally, it was the first major Hollywood film shot in proper consideration for a black person. Cinematographer Haskell Wexler realized that standard lighting produced too much glare and adjusted it to feature Poitier with better photographic results, a small step, but a necessary one. An anti-establishment statement, Cool Hand Luke deconstructs a false myth of prisons as rehabilitation systems, instead depicting harsh punishment, psychological cruelty, and sadistic treatment at the hands of the wardens. The imprisoned are the heroes, and the imprisoners are the villains.
Huh, I think she's cute.
Didn't she, though? I guess we put him in a woman's cell, don't you reckon?
Oh, I think we ought to put him in a cage and charge a little admission to see him.
Those are what are known as country witticisms.
I can't believe they're here. What are they doing here? I don't know.
Easy Rider widened the generation gap with its rallying cry encouraging drifters, wanderers, and free spirits alike to join in on its quest of searching for meaning in a confusing culture. Easy Rider illuminated prejudice in an unorthodox and captivating manner. It became a touchstone in independent American cinema.
Well, one of them darn sure is not Ula. Looked like a bunch of refugees from a gorilla lovey and...
A gorilla couldn't love that.
Nor could a mother.
As the change of the countercultural revolution faded, cinema reflected the despair that lingered in a country fatigued by war, societal clashes, and concealed misconduct. The inability to turn back time.
I reckon the reason why I always drag you out here is probably I'm just as sentimental as the next fella when it comes to old times.
The Last Picture Show represents the loneliness of small-town Texas and the suppressed pain of its stagnant residents and their indecision that pervades their relationships, friendships, and sense of autonomy. It is steeped in a nostalgia for earlier, brighter days, but also remarks that maybe those days weren't as bright as they thought. It includes several taboos in its depiction of nudity, an affair between an older woman and a younger man, and social expectations of virginity. Serpico gained recognition as a film involving an idealistic cop who uncovered rampant corruption in the New York Police Department that led to his working as a whistleblower to expose the malfeasance. It was adapted from a biography of the real man, Frank Serpico.
Yes, Lee, how are you?
Senator Carroll, just fine, thank you. Welcome to our city.
Rife with conspiracy and paranoia, The Parallax View is a taut thriller influenced by the assassinations of John F. Kennedy and the mysterious deaths of the witnesses that followed, as well as Bobby Kennedy's assassination. Inspired by and inspiring countless conspiracy theories, the film is a paragon of cultural machination.
He wants to kill me so bad he can taste it!
Oh God, I was gonna kill
him! Attica! Attica!
Attica!
Attica!
Attica!
Attica!
Dog Day Afternoon, like Serpico, is based in fact. It centers around a real-life bank robbery and ensuing hostage situation from 1972. In the events of the film, the hostages stuck inside the bank develop something akin to Stockholm Syndrome, protecting their captors from police and refusing to negotiate. Al Pacino's character emerges from the bank to yell Attica at the cops and negotiators, recalling the Attica prison riot that occurred months earlier. The crowd gathering on the street supports the robbers as well. All these events happened in reality, demonstrating a shift away from compliant obedience to authority. It is a powder keg of a film, brimming with explosivity and political bravado. All the President's Men, a cutting portrait of the Watergate scandal, illustrated the loss of faith in American politicians as reporters Bernstein and Woodward follow the trail of Nixon and his confidant's deception as the journalists fight indoctrination to break the shocking news of the cover-up. It is a battle for truth and the ability to tell truth.
Are you Shevotarevich? Are you sure?
Shevatulevich. Is that a Russian name?
No. It's American.
The deer hunter meditated on the devastating effects of the Vietnam War and the suffering it inflicted on a group of three childhood friends. While each man deals with the pain in different ways, it is nevertheless a tragic and harrowing film and stands strongly in opposition to violence, war, and conflict. There are many problems evident with historical depictions of non-white, non-male populations in film, but there is a necessity to recognize the pitfalls of less varied representation in the medium. Someone without a special connection to cinema may not comprehend the importance of independent and innovative film. Some may posit film is only a reactionary medium, one that functions as a reflection of the times. And it is that, but it is much more than that. It is a reflection and a reflector, the change and the changed, the storyteller and the story. It is obvious in retrospect that the decades following World War II were transformational for America and the film industry, both studio and independent, played a lead role.
You know what you done there? You told my story. You told my whole story right there, right there. One time I told you I was gonna make you somebody, that's what you done for me. You made me somebody they're gonna remember.